Hi, I'm your host, Kirsten Quinn, and you're watching the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on CCP-TV, Community College of Philadelphia's Emmy-nominated educational channel. Tonight, we are very lucky to have Randy Peterson as our special guest. Randy has lived and worked in the Philadelphia area most of his life, balancing his creative interests such as writing, playwriting, directing, acting, and teaching. As a freelancer, he has written more than 50 books. His latest is The Printer and the Preacher, a historical study of the friendship between Ben Franklin and great awakening preacher George Whitefield. He has directed plays in various theaters, schools, and churches, including A Moon for the Misbegotten at South Camden Theater and Greater Tuna with Actors Core Theater Company, which he co-founded. Randy has taught acting at Eastern University in the Ritz Theater and public speaking at Camden County College. He has a master's in theater from Villanova. Randy will be reading for us from his book, The Printer and the Preacher, tonight. Please welcome the super talented and prolific Randy Peterson to the show. Welcome, Randy, and thank you so much for being here today with us. I really appreciate your coming in. It's a very cold day today, so very happy to have you here. And I just want to sort of jump right in because we've got a lot to talk about, I think. Yeah, so I'm going to first talk to you about your sort of your entry into the creative process and how you started to become an artist and where that came from.
Well, I came from a very creative family. Mm-hmm. My father is a writer and editor. My mother was an English teacher.
Okay.
And so we learned language and a love for creativity early on. My brother still works as a writer and editor, and my sister is an actress and playwright and theater teacher on her own. I've got lots of creative influences in my life.
And you are a very creative person as well. You've done so much. I mean, ever since you went to Wheaton College, correct? Right. And what was that program like?
Well, we called it the workout group, and it had nothing to do with physical education. It was theater education, and but we would get together and do theater exercises, improvisations, mm-hmm. various theater games. It was, I think, ahead of its time.
Yeah.
Our professor had come out of the 60s and was influenced by a lot of that sort of living theater background, experimental theater, and wanted to train us. Not only in how to say lines, but how to live them, how to use our bodies and our full emotional repertoire and interaction. And we worked a lot with interactive exercises to develop the ability to work with each other, develop strong ensemble. There was a group of 30 people we were the theater group. All the plays were cast from that
group.
And we met together twice a week just for these exercises, and so it really was a groundbreaking program, I think, for its time, but also in our lives. And I still meet people that I got to know back then, we connect very well, and it has shaped our lives in a lot of ways.
I'll bet. Yes. And it seems like you said it was groundbreaking. There's something called the Viewpoints, which was created by Anne Bogart. And this is sort of a predecessor to that.
Well,
not
officially, but I think a lot of the ideas that we were working with back then, then later were also developed. As I have gotten to know Anne Bogart and the Viewpoints program a little bit from reading and study, I've been fascinated by the similarities there. That I mean, certainly she has taken it to great new places there. But it's the same sort of theater language underlying all of that.
That's great underlying training, too. I mean, it's really good, very strong training. I mean,
absolutely.
If you think, just for context, she teaches at Columbia, I believe, and runs the City Theater, SITI.
Right.
Yeah, and their work is really impressive. There's a spiritual component to the work, too. Could you talk a little bit about this? Because I know you bring spirituality and are fascinated by it in your work.
Well, yes, and that's why Wheaton College is a Christian college, and so they're focusing on spiritual aspects of all of their the education that they offer there. But in theater there too, yes, there was this sense of interaction with others at a spiritual level as well, and we learned to support each other and trust each other and sort of love each other in the act of doing theater with each other. And so yes, definitely a strong spiritual component.
That's
and
beautiful.
Actually, just a year ago or so, I was teaching at Eastern University. Mm-hmm. I had the opportunity to come in for a semester, and they had a very similar program that was actually established by an old classmate of mine from Wheaton. He had established what they call the Actors Lab there, and I was fortunate enough to come in for a semester and continue that program, and which I understood very well from my own college training years ago.
I would love to take a class in this. You should maybe do some classes or workshops on this and you know, learn about it from me, from my perspective.
I'll set you up.
Yeah, that'd be great. I did a little, you know, we could do it here. You know,
right.
Why not? I mean,
sure.
It'd be a lot of fun, I think, for the students and for us.
Yes.
As faculty to learn about that, because it's a really interesting process. You've mostly been writing. Is that your, like, mainstay? Is that...
Yes.
You know, I mean, you do a lot. But I'm just saying, like, in terms of the mainstay thing.
Yes, and I think to some extent that's because I'm too cowardly to enter the theater world professionally. Actors go out into the world and put themselves in auditions.
Yeah.
You know this.
Oh, yeah.
And
it can be
it's
very
a
demoralizing.
Scary thing. It's demoralizing. you work really hard and you often don't get paid that much, and you never know when your next job is going to be. And so all of that meant that early on, as I was trying to find a career for myself, I decided writing is a little more secure. Not a lot more, but
know.
A little more.
I can do the writing thing. I think that it's, you know, to write a long, you know, long nonfiction piece or novel or book, you know, a book, like you've written so many books, that would be very intimidating to me. So,
well, I got a job with a magazine for about 5 years, and then the talk about security, that magazine folded, and
it happens.
And I was looking for other work, but began to develop freelance clients. And there were a number of people I had met while working on the magazine who were now giving me work to do as a freelancer. And so that was just working out for me. And I was making not a great living, but a decent living as a writer. And as a freelancer, then it also gave me free time to pursue my other creative interests in the theater. And so I was sort of avocationally doing the theater, developing as a director, as a playwright, as a teacher of theater. And it was a good situation for me because I was, you know, 80% of my work was writing.
Right.
And I could still do a lot of these theater things and develop as a theater person on the side.
I think
then
that's
too.
What most of us do, I mean, or have to do, but it's also, you know, having that underlying security, having that base can really allow you more freedom, I think, to be able to feel, okay, I can, like, let my creative juices flow, I can let this happen, and it's not, you know, it's not that I have to rely on this for my income, and I don't have to rely on the next job. I can do what, you know, I can do what I can, and then, you know, and look for projects I really am interested or want to do. So that's really great. Tell us about some of the theatrical work you've done. I mean, you've written plays as well. You've directed several productions all over the place.
Yes, I was commissioned by Wheaton College to write a couple of plays in the years after I had graduated, and that were produced in their in their main stage season. I have continued to write one-act plays, and I've teamed up with a couple of other playwrights, a composer and a playwright to do, we did a piece called Jailbirds about 6 or 7 years ago. We rented the Walnut Street Studio 5 space up there.
Love
and produced that for 2 weekends there. And it was it's we called it a breakout musical. It was about women in prison, but it was actually based on a real life story of a number of prominent women in the 50s were at this minimum security prison in West Virginia. It is the same prison that Martha Stewart went to a number of years ago, and and so but at the time Billie Holiday was there. There was a notable communist. There was a which you weren't allowed to be a communist back then, so they put you in jail. and there was a woman who had been sort of the Tokyo Rose of Germany in the World War II, and so she was captured and put in this prison. And so, just very interesting and accomplished women here in this prison. And so, with that as a base, my playwright friend developed the story of let's imagine that they're supposed to do a Christmas show for the prison. What would that look like? And then there's some young woman who's there in the prison that they need to break her out of prison. And so it becomes this caper where they're breaking her out of prison. And it's a musical. And so we added music to that. A very skilled composer, Andre Vermeulen, wrote some really great music for that. Alex Wilkie is the playwright. I wrote the lyrics, and I did sort of the dramaturgical work on that and developing the piece, and I directed it when we produced it. So that was a nice, a very nice creative outlet for me to be involved with that. People, the 200 people who came to see it over those 2 weekends they loved it. We've sought to do some other things with it, but haven't yet found the right home for that. Yeah. But I still work with them. There's a new piece we're looking at. The reunion of a punk group from the 80s. And now, you know, they all have kids and families and whatever, but they're getting together again to do a reunion tour. And what would that look like? And of course, we've all had to learn punk music to work on that. So it's still in the works. But that's some of the playwriting there. Directing has been I really love directing. Mm-hmm. I like telling other people what to do. And
you're a good director. Your work is great.
Yes, we interacted a little bit with Moon for the Misbegotten at South Camden Theatre Company, and that was a really great experience. O'Neill's work is obviously wonderful.
Brilliant.
And I was privileged to be part of the initial season in South Camden's new space there. They built that great new theater, and this was the last show in that first season. Mm-hmm. And so I was honored to be a part of that there.
That's such a great space, and it's so, we've had some folks from South Camden Theater come on and talk about the community and bringing theater to the community, and it's really one of the only theaters in that area, if not the only theater in that area, aside from the college's theater, Camden County Community College's theater.
Right.
It's great to have that in a community.
And they have this great vision of really restoring that community through the arts. And so it's great to be a part of that as well.
And they do really solid professional work.
I mean,
you've got a lot of great people in there, not just directors and producers, but the actors as well, and everybody coming together. I mean, they really know what they're doing.
Yes, it's a very small stage. It's a challenge to work on that, to mount a play there, but it really creates a great intimate theater experience for the audience there. So,
love that.
Yes.
Really love that. Yeah. And you've directed quite a bit at, and also acted at Haddonfield Plays and Players in the Ritz Theater. In New Jersey.
Yes. When I was first out of college and back in this area, I started with Haddonfield Plays and Players and did, I think my favorite role there was Joseph in Joseph and His Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, and what a great role to have there. But then the Ritz was just starting at that point.
Okay.
And so I began working there. And it was a somewhat more professional style there.
Right.
And so got involved with them, not only as an actor. And my favorite role there was Arthur in Camelot. And just loving that. But I got involved behind the scenes. I was
right.
editing the newsletter that they put out, but also developing a one-act play program there.
Oh, nice.
So on one Wednesday night a month, we would have the Wednesday evening theater series, and we
okay.
would do one-act plays there. It was sort of a minor leagues for the main stage
yeah.
productions. People could learn their acting and directing skills through
yeah.
that. And I learned some directing skills by directing mm-hmm. things there myself. But I also started teaching classes there. So it was a great, as this sort of semi-professional theater,
yeah.
it was a great way to develop myself
yeah.
as a director,
yeah.
as a teacher, and as an actor.
Yeah.
So it's been a rewarding relationship through the years.
Whenever you can make something a learning experience and have that, it's, you know,
yes.
I always say that acting outside of the college and teaching is great for me, because not only do I get the experience of being, you know, a professional in the field, but also that I can bring some of the things I've learned into the classroom,
yep.
and I learn a lot, and, you know, and hopefully can transmit some of that to my students. And it's exactly what you're saying right now, you know, and,
yep.
and being able to teach in the same place that you're acting and directing is even better, because
right.
then you're bringing stuff from that group
right.
that, you know, that you're working on as a collaborative effort. That's really cool.
And actually, it was through the Ritz
yeah.
that a former teacher of mine from high school, my high
mm-hmm.
school Latin teacher, was a theater lover, saw me in Camelot, I believe,
yeah.
and
yeah.
came up to me afterward and said, we're looking for someone to direct the musicals
mm-hmm.
at Gateway High School.
Yeah.
Would you be interested in that? And I said, sure.
Yeah.
Well, I was a freelancer and looking for gigs. And
let's do it. All right.
So they were
let's
paying
do that
real
job.
Money to do that. And so
yeah.
I did that for the next 11 years.
Wow.
And so directed the musicals each spring. And that was an education for me
yeah.
In musical
it's a
theater.
Lot of work.
And in education itself,
mm-hmm.
that working with students. And of course, a high school musical is going to have 70 kids in the cast.
I was just going to say,
yeah.
I don't even know how that works out. Like, how does
yes.
that happen? In the
you
end.
It just has to happen.
At some
point, it's conducting. It's just it's placing people on stage, and you come on at this line, and you're a bush, you're a
yeah.
tree, and then you exit on this line, and but even that, and Gateway as a junior senior high school,
mm-hmm.
7th through 12th grade,
yeah,
we really saw how some of these kids would be the third one from the left,
right.
as a 7th grader, and then
yeah.
5 years later, we're still working with them. It's sort of an ensemble kind of thing
sure.
there, and we get 6 years with them, and so
wow.
so by the time they're seniors, they're the stars of the show,
yeah,
and
so see their progression through the years as actors,
yeah.
performers,
yeah,
that's awesome. Yeah, I have some information and some interesting facts that you worked at the great People's Light Theater out in Malvern, is it, I believe?
Yes. Yes.
And your sister has done stuff
well,
out there. I've seen
yes.
your sister in many different shows.
Yeah. My sister, Catherine
yeah.
Peterson, has been a company member
mm-hmm.
at People's Light
yeah.
through the years. She's now teaching at Arcadia University
mm-hmm.
And writing plays and acting here and there around town. And,
yeah.
But back about 15 years ago, they had a summer. It was sort of a fringe festival kind of thing
mm-hmm.
just for that theater.
Yeah.
And so they were doing like 18 different shows during the summertime
yeah.
at People's Light. And one of the things they had was this new thing called a panto.
Mm-hmm.
That there was a British author who had moved to the area. He had written this this silly play based on Dick Whittington and his cat, an old children's story. And my sister was given this to direct.
Okay.
There. It was her directing debut.
Yeah.
And so no one knew what a panto was. And since then, they've been doing pantos as their holiday shows.
It's
in
very
December.
Very successful.
Very successful, very popular. My sister has written most of those shows,
has
actually.
She?
Yes. And so that whole community, they know what pantos are. And it is really this sort of silly musical comedy romp that they do. At the time, they didn't know about this, and they were doing so many other shows that the People's Light regulars were all booked doing other shows, and so they needed some extra people. Mm-hmm. And my sister said, I need a guy who can sing, and Randy, you know how to sing, so would you like to come out and do this?
You
this
should
thing?
Be doing that all the time out there. you'd be great. That's great.
Well,
really cool.
It was a great experience. It was great to meet those people I had seen on stage there in play after play, and to actually work with them and get to know them was a really rewarding experience.
Yeah, you founded some companies as well.
Well, yes. I guess at times I have followed the idea that if no one is giving you work as an actor, you know, make your own. And so I've had some groups of people that have sort of gathered around me on a couple of occasions to create theater. And so in the late 90s, there was a group that we called the Encore Theater Company. I think there are about 1,000 companies around the country called the Encore Theater Company, but
that's all right.
But that was just the name we chose. And we only lasted a couple of years. We did a couple of review shows, but we also wrote a musical that we called Creating, that we were creating ourselves, and about artistic processes and whatever. And so that was a great experience. Then a few years later, in the early 2000s, I banded together with a couple of actors from the Ritz, actually, to form Actors Core Theater Company.
Yes.
Greater Tuna was our main production there, and the two main guys, Greg Priwusha and Ray Croce, were just brilliant comic actors.
Yeah.
And they wanted to do this show. They needed a director, so they called me, and we formed this company and did Greater Tuna several times, but also some other shows. We lasted for about 5 years, and none of us was that business-minded. So
Very few artists are.
Exactly.
I know I'm not.
Yeah. And so we weren't really building a company. We were just doing theater. And
you enjoyed it, and it was something that lasted for a while. I mean, and you were, you know, Greater Tuna. That's a great.
That's a really great
play. I mean, that's an excellent play for our audience. If you haven't seen that, you know. And
very funny. You know, it's two actors each playing a dozen different roles, and so costume changes, quick changes, and all kind of having lovable fun with a little town in Texas that called Tuna, Texas.
Yeah.
That. So very funny, and the whole idea of it with all the costume changes is just brilliant. And I was working with the right actors for that, and it was a great experience for that time. And we disbanded the company before we lost any money on it. So
that's good. That's good. You don't want to lose money if you can help it.
Yes, exactly.
You went to Villanova too.
This was my midlife crisis. Yes, this was the 2006. I went there, and no, seriously, I had been doing this sort of amateur theater along the way, and you know, so they paid me a little something to direct at the high school, and we were trying to make money with Actors Corps. We didn't, but you know, these different things that I was doing as a freelancer, and I just wanted to up my game.
Yeah.
I wanted to kind of learn how to do the things that I was already doing.
Right.
And so I felt it was time to get a master's degree in theater, and looked around. Villanova seemed to have the right program.
Great
for
program.
Me. And it really was. I learned a lot. There's an academic quality to Villanova's program that it is it's known for its dramaturgy, and a lot of people come out of that and become dramaturgs for different theaters in town and around the country, actually. But it was great to meet the professors and get to know them, and also the fellow students there. And I was taking the slow ride through it. I still had freelance writing to do, and so I was taking a couple courses at a time. So I was there for 4 years, doing a two-year program for 4 years.
Yeah.
And in the process, then I met, you know, five different classes of students, and so some really great people that I keep in touch with now.
Good.
And. And so coming out of there, I was looking, okay, maybe I can teach theater now at a college level.
Yeah.
And
which you had already done, but
Well, I not at college level.
Oh,
so
not
I,
college
I had
level.
Been
okay.
working at a high school,
right,
and
right.
I had not yet been I had been teaching in theaters. But now I thought, okay, maybe I have the degree that would enable me to teach college theater. It is a competitive field there. There are a lot of people coming out of Temple and Villanova and coming into the area from elsewhere who have the skills to teach theater very well. And so it was hard to find the right spot there. I did wind up teaching public speaking at Camden County College.
Which is very related.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, it's performance in a way. It's you're teaching, you know, physical and vocal skills. Also, it sort of fit my writing experience in that you're creating a speech.
Yeah.
And you're developing your thinking and organizing it and putting it out there.
Yeah.
But what I loved about it, and especially in the community college setting, was that I was able to really help people find their voice and give them a skill that they could use in really any life context to succeed.
Yeah.
And so they go into business, they need to be able to talk there. They go into social life, into politics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course, you need to be able to construct a speech and speak it well. And so I really felt that I was making the world a better place by teaching this basic skill to so many of the community college students, so many of whom are really scrambling to succeed. You know, handing them tuition. They're working hard and you know, going to this school, and it's their attempt to try to make something of their lives. And so to be part of that was a really rewarding thing.
That's fabulous. So, and throughout this time you've been writing?
Yes.
And then I want to get into the book, The Printer and the Preacher, and talk a little bit about that. And you're going to read some passages from it. We'll talk about those.
Yes.
And if you could just give us a little background on how you decided to start this this book, and you know, what led you into this story and what intrigued you about these two men.
Okay.
And give us a little background before we get into the reading.
Well, as we've said, I've been freelance writing for a long time, and a lot of that is religious writing and writing materials, lesson plans for Sunday school classes.
Right, because you teach biblical
that sort of thing, youth material.
Yeah.
So my religious background feeds into that. Mm-hmm. I've done some work with psychologists, writing self-help books and that sort of thing. More recently, doing more history-based books, and then a friend of mine, actually he's my agent, suggested, you know, have you ever looked at the friendship between George Whitefield and Ben Franklin? And I had never looked into that. Now, I knew who George Whitefield was, a famous preacher of the Great Awakening in the 1700s in America. And of course, you can't live in Philadelphia without knowing who Ben Franklin
One
is.
One would hope.
Yes. And yet I had never put the two together. I never knew that there was a friendship between them. And yet there was. In Ben Franklin's autobiography, he writes for, you know, four or five pages about Whitefield and how they knew each other and how they worked together on some projects. So I began to research this and found that, yes, there was more than those five pages. There were letters that passed between them. Each of them wrote about the other on a few occasions. And there was still the question, is there enough here for a book? But the more I looked into it, the more I thought I could dig into each of their backgrounds, how they grew up, what they what their ideas were, and how they affected the country that was coming to be in the 1700s. And the more I looked into all of that, the more I felt, yes, there's a book here. We can do this. And so I put together a proposal and submitted it to a publisher, and my agent was helping me with all of that. And we got a contract, and I set about writing the book. And and it was an extremely valuable experience for me. A lot of fun, a lot of hard work, but fun as well.
And congratulations on it, too. Oh, that's a big endeavor to take on and to succeed at it. So congratulations.
Yes, well, we'll see if it succeeds. I'm still haven't gotten to the sales reports lately, so I'm not sure how well it's selling, but it was certainly, even if it doesn't sell, at least I've had a good time researching it and writing it.
Great. So would you like to read some from?
Well, yes, I would.
Let's see the cover first. I'm going to hold it up for the printer.
The printer and the preacher. So this is an earlier kind of rough version of it, but it's all spiffy and hardback as well.
Yeah, I know. I have a copy of it myself.
So yes, before I read, I want to set this up because they really were. If I were to ask you, who were the two most famous people in America in the mid 1700s, 1740 to 1760, that era. George Washington really isn't on the scene yet. Jefferson's just a kid. Who are the most famous people? Well, Ben Franklin, we would say that.
Yeah.
But the other was George Whitefield, who was even more famous than Franklin was. That he preached in England and then brought it to America, and people flocked to hear him preach. And so these two most famous people, very influential people, they were also friends. And what a great way to start a book. So so from the opening of the book, I'll read a couple of pages and you'll get a flavor. Oh, and I need my glasses to do this. I am of an age where that needs to happen. They were the two most famous men in America. Both had enormous impact on the colonies that would become the United States. In the decades before George Washington came to fame, while Jefferson and Adams were still in school, the strands of American DNA were being twirled together by a printer and a preacher, Benjamin Franklin and George Whitefield. With his dramatic preaching, Whitefield led the Great Awakening that established a spiritual groundwork for the American colonists. They were no longer merely Anglican, Presbyterian, or Baptist, but Christian, freed from the old establishment and united in an exciting new experience of faith. With his wry writing and thirst for knowledge, Franklin helped to forge a uniquely American personality. His Poor Richard's Almanac set the tone. Americans could revel in their homespun humor, their hardscrabble common sense. Franklin's own life trajectory, from laborer to entrepreneur, to politician, to scientist, to diplomat, proved his point. In this new world, no one had to bow to nobility. Success was available if you were willing to work for it. With this in mind, Franklin created a stunning array of social structures, a library, a fire brigade, a hospital, and many others that knit together the citizens of the emerging country. Long before any talk of independence, he was already building a nation. These two celebrities, George and Ben, knew each other, liked each other, supported each other, and challenged each other. Through conversations, letters, business projects, and meetings in Philadelphia and London, the two men carried on a meaningful friendship for more than 30 years. That's just the beginning of it. I talk more about them, of course, throughout the book.
Yeah.
One of the challenges here for me in writing it was trying to figure out whether there really was a friendship here, how deep it went. They were they started out as business colleagues there. They sort of needed each other in that way. One historian that I encountered said, Franklin made Whitefield famous, Whitefield made Franklin rich. And there is some truth to that, although not entirely, because Franklin was already doing pretty well. He had already written Poor Richard's Almanac. He was a best-selling author. He was a successful printer and a leading citizen in Philadelphia already before he met Whitefield in 1739.
Right.
But he got a lot richer when he started publishing Whitfield's material.
Right.
Everyone wanted to read stuff by Whitfield, his sermons, his autobiography, his journals, anything that they could find that Whitfield had created. They wanted to buy that. And so Franklin was the main publisher, not the only one, but the main publisher of Whitfield's material. And so he really, he made a mint, you might say, with Whitfield's material. And he brought to that process his own sort of publicity machine. Okay. He had a network of newspapers around the country, his own newspaper in Philadelphia, the Pennsylvania Gazette. And he had ideas for selling books, a subscription plan that he sort of pioneered, that people could, you know, pay a little each month and get a regular supply of books about Whitfield. And so Franklin was really good at selling Whitfield's material, and so he made money off of it, and also advanced Whitfield's career there too. Whitfield was already famous in England before he met Franklin. Franklin helped to make him just as famous and even more so in America.
Yeah.
Whitfield traveled up and down the coast.
Did he?
Every colony, from New Hampshire to Georgia.
Wow.
It is estimated, I read the historian saying, that half of the people in the American colonies heard Whitfield speak in person.
Isn't that amazing?
And everyone else knew who he was. And, and so he was. He would often preach three times a day. He preached out in the open, often because churches didn't like him very much, because he was challenging the the establishment there. Again, it wasn't, you didn't need to be Anglican or Presbyterian. It was just respond to God individually.
Right.
That was his message.
Sort of a radical idea at the time.
Very much. Mm-hmm. And so he would speak somewhere, jump on a horse, ride 20 miles, get out and preach again, jump on the horse again and go preach somewhere else.
Yeah.
And it was a grueling schedule, but it also reached nearly everybody in America. Everyone knew who he was, and people were responding. So this Great Awakening was this spiritual revival where people were taking sort of individual ownership of their spiritual lives. You're not just a church member.
Yeah.
You are someone responding to God's call on your life.
Yeah.
And that was the message Whitfield was preaching, and it was wildly popular.
Yeah.
So the question was, okay, friendship. Are they friends? And how do we know that? Well, there are these letters that pass between them, and which suggest that it's a little bit more than a business relationship.
Yeah.
You know how you turn on a TV show in the middle and somebody says something, and you kind of know that it's in answer to something that went on earlier in the program.
Sure.
We get that sense with these letters. We don't have all the letters, and we don't have all the conversations that they had.
Of course not. Right.
But we have some of the letters. So there's one letter that Whitfield writes pretty early in his relationship. Mm. So he meets Franklin in 1739. And tours around the colonies, keeps coming back to Philadelphia. It's sort of a hub for him. And he writes a letter when he's about to go back to England. He's just seen Franklin about a week and a half earlier, and he writes this letter back to him saying, "I do not despair of your seeing the reasonableness of Christianity. Apply to God, seek to know the divine will, and he will show it to you." So it's old English language, but it's one of those things where they must have been talking about this before.
Sure.
They must have had a conversation where Whitfield is saying, "Ben, you got to be born again." And Ben's saying, it doesn't seem reasonable to me.
I'm not into that. Debate going back and forth between them.
And so here's a letter where Whitfield is saying, "I'm not giving up hope. I don't despair. You're eventually going to see the reasonableness of what I'm preaching here. And ask God about it, and God will show you how right I am about this." So it does give us that flavor of an ongoing conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And really, over the next 30 years, they were carrying on this conversation in letters and in their face-to-face meetings. So we do get hints of a deeper relationship there with
them
really
30 years.
Affecting each other. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And The next question that I had was how much are they affecting, how important is this friendship mm-hmm. in the larger society? How are they affecting America? In fact, mm-hmm. the subtitle, which I love, is is The Surprising Friendship That Invented America.
Yeah.
And I've had a little pushback on that. Did they really invent America? How did that work?
They did.
But you look at Franklin and the social structures that he was creating. Mm-hmm. You think about that, starting a library.
Yeah.
Okay, before that, if you're rich enough, you can buy a book. Because books were printed in England, most of them,
right.
before Franklin started printing in America. And it costs a lot of money to import a book from England. And so only the rich people can. And so only the rich people are buying books, reading books, getting educated.
Yeah.
And the common workers really can't, unless you have a library, unless
right.
everyone pools their money to buy a bunch of books that they all take turns reading.
Yeah.
What a democratic idea.
Yeah.
And yet, and Franklin is the one who gets that going in Philadelphia, and
wow.
that extends to other cities from there. So it's a social structure that is really paving the way for a democracy yeah. to emerge later. The fire brigade. You know, people joining together to save mm-hmm. to save a town. But it wasn't just about putting out fires. They got together every month for a barbecue, you know,
yeah.
to talk about fire stuff.
Yeah.
And Franklin set this up, a social thing that people, he's inventing America. He's inventing the structures of America.
Yeah.
And in the same way, Whitfield was inventing a new way of not only thinking about God, but about that people could think about themselves.
Right.
That they had an individual responsibility to respond to God.
Within themselves.
Within themselves.
Yeah.
And not just something that their church could do for them.
Right.
And again, the dominant churches at the time were the Anglican Church, mm-hmm. run from England,
sure.
Presbyterians with a strong English connection there.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was a sort of independence
mm-hmm.
of these establishment structures
yeah.
that Whitfield was preaching there on an internal level.
Hmm.
And so the internal responsibility that Whitfield was preaching together
mm-hmm.
with the social connections that Franklin was espousing created the foundation
mm-hmm.
for a new nation.
Yeah.
Here. And so I think they both
invented
America.
That makes
America
sense.
In that
I mean,
way.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, because those are two really key things.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to read a little bit more about being in Philadelphia. We can
yeah.
read about Philadelphia.
Okay,
and,
great. Yeah. Philadelphia Cultural Forum, here we are.
That's right.
We've got Philadelphia, we've got culture, and we've got some great writing.
Philadelphia is still Ben Franklin City. You can cross the Ben Franklin Bridge from Jersey, exit the expressway onto the Franklin Parkway, and visit the Franklin Institute.
Mm-hmm.
Stay in the Franklin Residences on Chestnut and take a tour of the Franklin Mint. Or perhaps you'd rather see a game at Franklin Field at the University of Pennsylvania, which Ben sort of founded.
Yeah.
Head back to Old City and tour the newly renovated Franklin Museum on the site where he lived and worked. Walk along those streets, Market, Chestnut, Walnut, and you're likely to pass the locations of several outfits he had a hand in. The post office, a branch of the Free Library, the American Philosophical Association. You'll even pass the Benjamin Franklin beer distributors. Really.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Stroll through the courtyard behind Independence Hall, where Ben did some of his best work. You might actually see a Ben Franklin impersonator walking beside you with the classic spectacles, pudgy face, white hair, and balding pate. At 4th and Arch, you can see his final resting place shared with his wife, father-in-law, daughter, and son-in-law. Across the street is a fire company established by, well, you can probably guess. William Penn founded this town, but Ben Franklin made it.
Mm.
Penn laid out its streets, but Franklin knit them together. Penn christened the city with its Greek name, meaning brotherly love, but Franklin loved it like a brother, even more so. Philadelphia was also sort of a base of operations for George Whitfield. This preacher was always on the move, so it's hard to think of any American site as his home, except possibly the orphanage he founded in Georgia. Yet Whitfield preached repeatedly to huge crowds in Philadelphia, and he kept coming back to the city.
Hmm.
This was where most of his literature was printed by Franklin, and this was where citizens constructed a building for his converts, a project Franklin helped to fund and manage. This eventually became the institution that became the University of Pennsylvania. The City of Brotherly Love was a good fit for Whitfield. At the time of his first visit, it was the second largest city in the colonies, and before his last visit, it surpassed Boston as the largest. Mm. It was also more centrally located than Boston or New York. For the promotion-conscious Whitfield, there was no better place to make a splash. Word of his preaching would travel fast, north and south. In fact, Franklin eventually set up a network of printers throughout the colonies to publish and distribute Whitfield's sermons and journals even more efficiently. After a brief trip to Georgia in 1738, setting up his orphanage, Whitfield felt called to conduct a preaching tour of the colonies. So in 1739, he headed straight for Philadelphia, like an arrow shot into the heart of America. He couldn't wait to get there. When the boat entered the Delaware Bay and docked temporarily at Lewis, George got out and rode north on horseback, later meeting his shipmates in the city, meeting some well-wishers along the way and preaching to them. And so on. It talks a little more about Philadelphia, but beautiful. It was a great experience being here in the city and walking around the city and learning so much about Franklin and also seeing where Whitfield did some of his work as well. Reading Whitfield's journals and talking about the different towns around Philadelphia that he preached in, and so Chester and Neshaminy and Trenton and Brunswick and all of those towns.
Let's hear some more.
Well, let's see. This is more about inventing America, so I talked a little bit about this, but it's so much better in the book. Whitfield and Franklin were not just the two most famous people in America in their time. They were also the most significant. The effects of their lives and their work are still being felt today. After George's death, Ben had two more decades in which he exerted enormous influence on the American nation that came to be. With the Continental Congress, Ben got to see a variation on a plan that he had earlier presented. He was also a force behind the Declaration of Independence and a signer of it. His shrewd diplomacy in France during the American Revolution probably turned the tide. Mm. Washington won the battles, but the French bought the guns, and their fleet scared the British into laying down their swords. That was largely a result of Franklin's careful wooing in the French court. Then, back in America, there was Franklin again, helping to craft the Constitution, doing what he always did best, creating society. He died in 1790 after dominating a century of mind-boggling change. But let's not overlook the impact of his early years as a printer, especially as he partnered with Whitfield. Ben was perhaps the first media mogul. His Pennsylvania Gazette wasn't the first newspaper in the colonies, but with his writings, it was surely the best. With his printing network, his yearly almanacs, and his later work as a postmaster, he managed the conduits of communication in this developing nation. Whitfield gave him material to work with. Before George showed up, the Gazette ran lost and found notices, the daily schedule of ships pulling up to the Market Street wharf, and whatever clever editorials Ben could think up. But suddenly, there were people screaming and fainting in church. There were meetings and fields and sermons from balconies. The newspaper had news. Ben had more content than he knew what to do with, except he knew exactly what to do with it. Books, pamphlets, newspapers. He fueled his mass media enterprise with the doings of his friend Whitfield. In the process, he changed the field of communications forever. Mm-hmm. The philosopher David Hume once criticized Franklin for making up new words, such as colonize. I didn't know that that wasn't a word before then, but Franklin kind of made that up. But that's what Franklin did. He created new forms of communication, and that's what the colonies needed, new ways of talking about a new kind of life. They weren't just going to be England West. Ben understood that. There were uniquely American attitudes and cadences in Poor Richard's homespun language. The practical wisdom, the self-deprecation, and the wry humor all became part of the American personality. Maybe he wasn't trying to set a tone for a new nation. He just made sure every colonist had access to his writing, and nearly everyone did. The media empire was just one of the building blocks of society that Ben hoisted into place, along with the library, the fire company, the militia, the hospital, and the college. These social organizations weren't always the first of their kind, but Ben custom made them for Philadelphia. And in some cases, they became models for other cities to follow. Long before he ever met with Congress or signed the Declaration, he was making America ready to become a nation. Mm-hmm. Whitfield was having a similar effect on the religious side of colonial life. His approach was decidedly personal, not ecclesiastical. You, yourself, needed a relationship with God. Mm-hmm. You needed to feel his presence within you. It was irrelevant which church you attended. In this way, though he was an Anglican minister, George broke the power of the Anglican Church in America. Or any church authority, really. No church could determine one's spiritual status. You had to take ownership of that and then give it to God. Powerful churches in England and America recognized this threat and denied access to Whitfield, forcing him out to the markets and fields. Yet that made the Whitfield revival all the more independent of church power. These were democratic spaces with no reserved pews, no privileged positions, no price of admission, just a preacher with a message and all the people who wanted to hear it. I'll stop there.
It's great. Independence.
Yeah.
Individuality.
Yeah.
Again, foundation of our country.
Yeah.
Democracy.
Yeah.
And you give us proof of that. I mean, that is the story.
Yeah. And I think there is this interesting combination of Franklin's social, civic nature there, mm-hmm. what he brings to the table, and the spiritual aspect that Whitfield mm-hmm. brings. I've thought a lot about what this friendship between these two men means today, mm-hmm. in our world today.
Yeah.
And there are some people who are very religious and mm-hmm. other people who aren't.
Right.
There's some people who are very civic-minded mm-hmm. and other people who aren't.
Yeah.
But these two men managed to make a friendship work.
Yeah.
They talked to each other even though they disagreed about fundamental things.
Yeah.
And yet they kept writing to each other. They kept talking to each other about those fundamental things.
Yeah.
There was a point late in his life where Franklin wrote to Whitfield. And in case you were thinking that Whitfield was annoying Franklin by continuing to try to convert him, Franklin surprises us by saying, you know, George, we should go and start a new colony in Ohio, which was, you know, the wilds of Ohio.
Right.
It was unsettled. It was wilderness.
Right,
and
right.
So just starting to be settled. And so Franklin says, the two of us, let's go out there and start a colony out there. Between your religion and my philosophy, mm-hmm. we could really show people how to make a colony work.
How about that?
I'm paraphrasing a great deal with that. But it's fascinating to see. And it's a pipe dream. They weren't really going to move out there. But
right. But
the idea that Franklin would even be free to suggest mm-hmm. that these two aspects of life belong together,
yeah.
that they could meet together and talk together and build a society yeah. on both of these factors of life. Mm. And I think that's something we need today. We need to talk to each other. We need to listen to each other.
Yes.
We need to form friendships between the people who focus on spiritual things, the people who focus on civic things, the people who have other interests.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk and listen and let people be who they are, but carry on the conversation
yeah.
in a nation that has a lot of different elements to it.
Yeah, if we can come together on issues that seem so separate, we can find our commonalities within that.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that's what they did.
Yeah.
And from what you describe, these are two great critical thinkers who understand that there are differences within, you know, within even the founding fathers of our nation. And they're able to communicate with one another about this and actually make strides to make this country happen, you know, without dividing it or changing it in a way that's kind of
or
disparate.
Even compromising what they themselves
right.
believed and,
right.
and were.
Right.
And that's what I find fascinating, that
yeah.
it wasn't just a matter of saying, oh, here's who I am, but I'll forget that and I'll
yeah.
pretend to be what you are.
Right.
It's not that. It's
right.
I mean, they continued to be strongly committed to the things they were committed
mm-hmm.
to. but they communicated and forged a direction that they both could follow and that the nation could follow after them.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your work with us.
Yes.
And just being a wonderful guest. Really, really a great episode for us, and I'm sure our audiences are going to love it.
Well, thank you.
So I really appreciate you being here, Randy.
It's been great being here.
And when you look for The Printer and the Preacher, this book is all over. I mean, it's being sold at every major bookseller throughout the country. So look out for that and support Randy there. I'm your host, Kirsten Quinn, and we hope to see you next time on the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on CCP-TV, Community College of Philadelphia's Emmy-nominated educational channel. Good night.